Good morning. Welcome you all to the discussion on the Journey of Petroleum Part 6. I am Jayaraj Nallathambi, Senior Process Design and Technical Safety Consultant in iFluids Engineering. Today we will discuss about hydrocracker unit, in which we will look at the plant overview, history of hydrocracking, chemistry of hydrocracking, process configurations, process description, and process variables we looked at. It's a process of treating and cracking of heavier hydrocarbon feed into lighter value-added products using hydrogen under high pressure and temperature in the presence of a catalyst. To upgrade heavier fractions of hydrocarbon feed to superior quality products, to meet the regulations on the aromatic and sulfur content of the product diesel to control harmful emissions. So the objective of the hydrocracker is to remove the metal from the feed, saturates the olefins, remove sulfur, removes nitrogen, saturates aromatics, convert feed to products, and it consumes hydrogen, and operating pressure is very high, around 250 kg per centimeter square gauge, and operating temperature is around 410 plus degrees Celsius. So by cracking heavier fraction of hydrocarbon to produce value-added products, the products are LPG, light naphtha, heavy naphtha, aviation turbine fuel or superior kerosene, HSD, and the off-gas produced in the process will be used as fuel in the refinery itself. This hydrocracker unit favors middle distillate yield. If you see the history of hydrocracking, the research says that necessity is the mother of invention. World War II had driven the innovative minds for many new ideas. When the necessity comes, ideas emerge. As long as the hydrocracker unit or any secondary process unit was developed, in crude distillation, we can produce here around 45 to 50% of the crude stock only to usable products. The remaining reduced crude is considered as a waste only. When the vacuum distillation is invented, then the remaining around 50 to 55% of the reduced crude is further improved to add value-added products, to produce value-added products, and thereby the yield percentage increased. However, in the vacuum column also, again certain product called as vacuum gas oil or VGO is not a directly usable product. To convert into a usable product, to make more value-added products, these secondary processing units are being introduced, in which hydrocracker is one of the most important units. It uses iron-based catalyst initially, very high pressure and temperature used by Germany, where those units produce high gas make, low octane naphtha, and poor quality diesel was the product of the first hydrocracker unit. First modern hydrocracking was introduced in 1959. In that process, amorphous silica and alumina catalysts are employed. Rapid growth of hydrocracking after development of zeolite-based hydrocracking, it is a state-of-the-art hydrocracking, that is catalyst is zeolite, lower pressure, that is 700 to 200 kg per centimeter square G, and the temperature is also moderate, around 340 to 410 Celsius, degree Celsius. In the chemistry of hydrocracking, various steps are there. First is removal of metal. Why we should remove the metal? Because the metal component in the feedstock will plug the pores in the catalyst. So the metal should be removed. Desulfurization, denitrification, olefin saturation, aromatic saturation, all these reactions take place are considered to meet the environment regulations or the specification of the product. And the hydrocracking is to convert the heavy molecule of the hydrocarbon, which is not usable directly, into a more value-added products like LPG, naphtha, diesel, kerosene, or aviation turbine fuel like that. The desulfurization unit, that is a desulfurization reaction, sulfur component is attached with the hydrocarbon, that is called a thiophene or thiol. So these, in the presence of hydrogen and catalyst under high pressure and temperature, the sulfur components converted into hydrogen sulfide by consuming hydrogen. At the same time, it's an exothermic reaction, so it releases lot of energy also. Removal of nitrogen, there is the amine compound. In this nitrogen is there, when it combines with hydrogen, it converts to ammonia, and by that this nitrogen is removed. This reaction is also an exothermic reaction only. Olefin saturation is another important reaction, because olefin are the unwanted product or limited product in this specification of the final finished products. So this olefin should be saturated. If the unsaturated presence in the product, that will lead to formation of gum on storage and gives problem in the fuel path of the engines or the plug of the engines. So the olefin should be saturated. Whatever the shortfall of hydrogen to get saturation, that hydrogen molecule is attached with olefins to convert into saturated paraffins. Aromatic compounds are converted into saturated naphthenes, because aromatics is a carcinogen creating compound. This is limited in the Euro 6. This is limited in the Euro 6 product specification. So large side chains are easily removed from the ring compounds. Saturated ring compounds crack easily. Paraffin compounds are hard to crack. That means saturated compounds are cracked to hard to crack. The feedstock for hydrocracker unit is straight line gas oil. Vacuum gas oil, there is nothing but LVG or HGO of vacuum distillation unit. De-asphalted oil, that is taken from asphalt. FCC cycle oil is one of the product from FCCU. Coker gas oil from delayed coker unit. Some distillate which cannot be directly used as a product and extract from lubrication unit. All these mix forms the feedstock for hydrocracker unit. The products we get from hydrocracker units are LPG, light naphtha is a feedstock for hydrogen generation unit. Heavy naphtha is a feedstock for reformer feed unit that will produce good quality gasoline, MS or petrol. Or it can be diverted to diesel pool also, when aviation turbine fuel or superior kerosene, HSD. Unconverted oil, that is a feedstock to downstream unit or FCC unit. And the off-gas produced is used in the refinery as a fuel. So again, the catalyst cracking reactions are permitted by acid sites. Hydrogenation by metal sites. Acid function is supplied by catalyst base such as silica, alumina or zeolite. Catalyst base depends on the type of product required. Metals such as molybdenum, tungsten, cobalt, nickel, platinum, palladium are dispersed on the catalyst base. Nitrogen in feed gets converted to ammonia through reactions, and ammonia so formed partially neutralizes the acid site, thus reducing the catalyst activity. So one of the main factor for the reduction of catalyst activity is removal of nitrogen. That is, by removal of nitrogen, it forms ammonia. That ammonia reduces the acid site. So any catalytic reactor or a hydrocracker reactor is a vertical column. Normally, the feed is introduced from the top. It's a downflow reactor. And the top of the reactor, there is always a particulate trap. It's a, like a bucket kind of trap. Feed will pass through the trap only to entrap or trap any foreign particle comes along with the feed. If the foreign particle goes along with the feed into the catalyst bed, it will create a choking in the, or a layer of foreign material will sit on it, that will create a lot of differential pressure in the reactor. So after this particular trap, distribution tray is there. This function of this distribution tray is to distribute the field along the entire surface of the reactor so that there will not be any channelizing of reactions, channelizing of passing flow through the reactor. So that should be avoided. For that, the distributor tray is provided. Then catalyst is filled. This portion is a catalyst. This is again a catalyst support tray. That is, catalyst should be supported on some base. That is the catalyst support tray. We already discussed that the entire reaction is an exothermic reaction. So lot of energy will be released, heat energy will be released to cool that, to prevent the reaction goes into runaway reaction. That should be quenched. For that, the quench flow is introduced here to reduce the temperature of the reactor. Again, liquid collector from the reactor. Then again, a distributor tray for even distribution of the field along the catalyst surface. This is again catalyst surface, catalyst filled area. So field is distributed. The same is repeating again, quench and liquid collector and distribution tray. So we can say that the top portion is the treating section, like denitrification, desulfurization, saturation of olefins, saturation of aromatics, all those things. Then the second and third is a cracking reaction take place here only. So the cracked products come are treated, are considered as the effluent of the reactor that is coming from the bottom of the reactor. So this is a schematic flow diagram. Here the feed is introduced and the feed is pressurized and pumped using a high multi-stage pump, which develop pressure at approximately 220 kg per centimeter square gauge, and the feed is preheated in the exchanger, that is the hot fluid or the effluent, hot effluent comes from the hydrocracker reactor, is preheating the feed. So it is a series of exchangers are there. In the series of exchanger, the feed is preheated. Approximately, we can say we are utilizing the exothermic reaction in the hydrocracker unit. The feed is preheated. The feed gains approximately 80% of the required heat from the preheat itself. Only 20% is modified or improved in the process furnace. So there is the advantage of the exothermic reaction. Lot of heat energy you can conserve and utilize in the feed stream to preheat. The 20% of the heat is given by the furnace. That is the important area where we can manipulate the temperature of the feed inlet. Here it is shown as a two reactors. That is, this is a hydro treating section and that one is a hydro cracker unit. And this is also a hydrocracker. So the effluent is preheating. Likewise, here also a furnace, and it is a two train, you can say, two trains of hydrocracker. So here also a hydrocracker reactor. That feed is also preheat, that effluent also preheating the feed and coming back to hot separator. The separator is the, whatever the effluent comes from the reactor, it all comes to the separator. From this separator, the lighter components are removed from the top. Bottommost one is the moisture content will be removed, and the side stream is the hydrocarbon liquid, which is going for further treating, that is to removal of hydrogen sulfide and all those things, stripping, amine absorption, everything is there. And after that, that is in the gaseous phase, amine absorber. The liquid is again considered, it is the feedstock for a product separation unit. That is, from the effluent, we have removed the gas phase. From the gas phase, majority hydrogen will be there and hydrogen sulfide also there. So this hydrogen sulfide is removed in an amine absorber. So hydrogen sulfide, free hydrogen and maybe little lighter hydrocarbon will go to a recycled gas compressor. And it is compressed and sent to hydrocracker reactor as a quench medium. At the same time, to augment hydrogen, to substitute the reactor hydrogen or consumed hydrogen. In the reaction, hydrogen is consumed. To augment that loss of hydrogen, Hydrogen, pure hydrogen, that is 99.99% purity hydrogen, is supplied by a compressor that is called as a makeup gas compressor. This compressor hydrogen and recycled gas is going to quench, and this is also added along with the feed. The mixer of feed stream and the hydrogen is going to react. So the effluent, after separating gas and sour water, the feedstock is going to a product separation. There is nothing but a distillation column. As we once discussed about the distillation column and crude distillation unit, the same principle is employed here also to separate the products. The products are separated as butanes, naphtha, jet fuel or kerosene, distillate or diesel, and the bottom one is unconverted oil. The fractionator, it is nothing but equal to a crude distillation column. It's the same principle is being employed here also. Here, in the distillation tower, the top one product is light ends and off gas, and some LPG also being produced. The naphtha, heavy naphtha, kerosene, diesel, and the bottommost is the feedstock to FCC unit. It is called as unconverted oil. And now we can say that in a crude, whatever the crude we purchase, only in crude distillation unit, that is atmospheric distillation unit, we can convert products around 45% of the crude unit only. Crude stock only. Then the reduced crude oil from the atmospheric distillation unit can be processed in the vacuum distillation unit, where it can be around 60 to 70% finished product can be produced. Whereas 15 to 25% of the product that is called as VGO cannot be used as a consumer product and is treated as a waste only. So this product, this stock is converted or cracked to form a smaller molecule of products by value addition, and we produce high value products from the low value feedstock. This is what hydrocracker unit is doing. Thank you all.